Yo, what's up? This is JayDennis with the JayDennis Podcast for Tuesday, January 21st, 2020. Yeah, what's up, man? We got 502 playing from Megadeth. Track 5 off of their So Far, So Good, So What album. You know why it's playing in the background? Sorry, I'm screaming. I'm just excited. You know why it's playing in the background? Because your boy got himself another original Megadeth CD. Yeah, so what are we at now? We have, out of their 15 albums, I have Peace Cells, So Far, So Good, So What, Rust in Peace, Countdown to Extinction, Cryptic Writings, Risk, do I really not have anything from the 2000s? Dystopia. Do I only have 7 Megadeth albums? Well, if that's the case, I'm about halfway there then. Because I still need Killing Is My Business. I still need Euthanasia. Still need The World Needs a Hero. System Has Failed, United Abominations, Endgame, 13, and Super Collider. Yep, that's it. I need 8 albums. And then I have 7, that's 15. All right. So I'm about halfway through the collection, and I've pretty much, for the albums that were remastered, pretty much every album leading up to 2001, or Risk, back in 1999, most of those I have are original versions, which most Megadeth fans like myself think the original sounded better than the remasters. The Rust in Peace that I have, unfortunately, is a remaster, but still sounds awesome because you can't fuck with Rust. But yeah, dude, why did I go out and buy myself an $8 CD at a used record store when I'm clearly struggling financially? I'll tell you why. Because this motherfucker closed the case! Ow! Yeah. Your boy finally got paid. And no, I'm not going to whip my dick out and be overly excited and assault your ear holes with my excitement. That's not what's going to happen here. I still have a lot of work to do, but this was a nice enough case to definitely give me a breath and, you know, kind of boost me towards getting some other shit done. And then, because I'm still in my first 3 years in the business, I get a bonus for everything I close to help subsidize. Oh, hold on a second. This is classic right here. Doesn't that just take you back to the late 80s? It sure does for me. Back when I was in my... I'm not gonna say it. I was born in 91, so this was before my time. But I still feel it, man. Yeah, definitely don't sleep on So Far, So Good, So What. It's a very underrated album. It's kind of a black sheep because it has like a one-time lineup. It was disjointedly recorded, but goddamn, it's got some amazing tracks on there. Yeah, so let's review, because there's 8 tracks here. I would say So Far, So Good, So What's definitely one of the most consistent albums. Like, I would put Peace Cells, the album before it, higher than this album on the ranking. But Peace Cells has a bad track on it. It's their cover song of I Ain't Superstitious. So, but then the following album, So Far, So Good, What? Same idea. It has 8 tracks, but their cover of Anarchy in the UK is actually good. And then the other 7 tracks, you know, Into the Lungs of Hell is an awesome opening track and an instrumental. Set the World Afire is a classic, underrated Megadeth track. I already mentioned Anarchy. Then we got Mary Jane, which is one of my favorite songs. 502, which you heard at the top of the podcast. And now In My Darkest Hour, which is the biggest song off this album. An 80s thrash metal anthem, even though it's a little on the slower side. Liar, which is a fun track. And then, of course, the album closes off with one of the best Megadeth songs, in my opinion, Hook in Mouth. So anyway, what was I talking about? Yeah, so your boy finally closed some business. So I went and celebrated. Kind of every 2 weeks, I go to the record store just to check to see if any new Megadeth albums came in. And by new, I mean old. And yeah, there it was, just right there at the top. It was right there. So Far, So Good, So What. Underneath it was another classic Countdown to Extinction album, but I already have that, so I'll let somebody else grace their collection with that. There's no sense in me having duplicates. Unless I wanted to gift it to somebody. What the fuck? No. I shan't be spending heavily right now. I didn't want to double. I could afford $8, but $16's a little much right now. I need to get back on track. I am getting back on track. This year's already going off a lot better. But you still need to move. I'm not getting cocky and acting like everything is okay. But things are becoming better. So, like, I knew that difficult era at the end of 2019, at least just difficult financially, it's all it was. That too should pass. It's still in the process of passing. But, like, we're okay. So yeah, this was going to be just a regular intro clip, but I'm going to do a two-part intro for this podcast because this Megadeth album has dominated this opening, and as well as how I got to it. So yeah, whenever I get paid or whenever I feel like celebrating, of course I'm going to treat myself to a new album. It's pretty much the only thing I will buy is an album or an old video game. That's pretty much the only physical stuff that I accumulate. And even though I have not bought new musical gear really at all the past 10 years, that would be another thing that I would get. Other than that, I do my best to not accumulate shit or clutter. You know, at least once a week, I call a couple of different companies that I get mail from and tell them to take me off their mailing list. It's like, I didn't ask for this shit. Get me off. I mean, I'm not a dick about it, but, you know, I was like, I don't want to be on your mailing list. I don't like getting mail. It's clutter. And even though I put it straight in the shredder, that's an extra task I have to do. So, yeah, I don't want mail. The only motherfucker I've not been able to remove myself from is Tom Steyer, the billionaire running for president on the Democrat side, who was just flooded the market with TV advertisements and mailers. I get like 5 mailers from him a week. And it's like, dude, I fucking agree with you. You know, Donald Trump's a piece of fuck. And he should be impeached. Yeah, congratulations on leading... Well, he is impeached now. But congratulations on leading the dialogue on that. And maybe being a better billionaire? Probably. Donald Trump's probably one of the worst billionaires of all time. That statement might not make sense to you, but it does. But it's like, no, dude, fuck off. I'm sick of seeing you. And I mean, I don't think you're going to be, but if you were the nominee, of course I'll vote for you, but fuck off. I want Bernie. Bernie's better. So yeah, I haven't been able to figure out how to get out of getting those goddamn mail. Yo, what's up? It's still, the podcast for Tuesday the 21st. It's actually Wednesday, okay? Yesterday was...
It was busy.
It was a busy day, so I didn't get around to recording it. Yeah, it kind of cut off there on the last clip because I was receiving a phone call. But yeah, so all in all, haven't been able to figure out how to get out of those mailers. But whatever. There's only so much you can control in this life. But before I get into the meat of this podcast, let's listen to one of the tastiest thrash metal moments of the 80s. So, what's refreshing about having an original version of this album is that particular part sounds, just this whole album, but that particular part you just heard sounds 1,000 times better, because the drumming actually sounds like it's drumming from the 80s. It doesn't sound like this more new age remastered crap that happened in 2004. So yeah, the classic mixing of the drums was way better. It was louder, it was more echoey, it actually sounded like an 80s thrash metal album. So Hook and Mouth is what we're listening to. It's one of my favorite Megadeth songs. But anyway, so yeah, it's Wednesday the 22nd, but I'm putting this podcast out, or the podcast is for the 21st. Let's talk about some football that happened this past weekend. I was absolute garbage at picking playoff games. I think I got about barely half of them right. I picked the Titans to upset the Chiefs, or I don't even know what would be an upset, because they were favored at like 30%. But, you know, it's just, you're going to pick against the Titans for the Patriots and for the Ravens, and they're going to fucking deliver? But I don't know, man. Patrick Mahomes is a stud. The Chiefs are really good. And I think Andy Reid just finally really, 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 really wants it. So they made it to the Super Bowl. And then I got the NFC game right. I got the 49ers over the Packers. I got that game right. So what's my Super Bowl pick? On paper, it looks like the 49ers would win. My guess would be because they have a better defense. And Jimmy Garoppolo is not to be underestimated. But I would love it. I want the Chiefs to win. So I live out in 49ers country right now. And, you know, I got some family here out here that are 49er fans. Of course, I got friends, too. I got friends out here, guys. But I would prefer to see the Chiefs win. You know, if we're looking purely at sentimental reasons, the Chiefs haven't won a fucking Super Bowl in, like, what, 50 years? And the 49ers won one. Or at least they had an appearance. They had an appearance back against the Ravens early last decade. And then they probably won a Super Bowl during the Joe Montana days, at least. Something. So yeah, my heart says the Chiefs. My brain barely says the Chiefs, because I just think Patrick Mahomes is a stud right now. Like, the guy's a fucking monster, and I love that guy. So I want him to win. And the Chiefs, too. And plus, that Kelsey guy's no slouch either. He's older, but he's definitely very reminiscent of Gronkowski and his receiving abilities and Hook and Mouth. Just listen to that snare. That's just a classic headbanging riff. Like, when I hear that, I just want my hair to grow out long and I could just bang my fucking head to that to the point where I'm a chiropractor's wet dream. Anyway, speaking of music, what I've really been focusing on the past couple of weeks, and if you heard me talk about it on the podcast, is the In Flames discography. I'm finally creating a playlist of all my favorite tracks from all the albums. That's what I do when I get into a new band that has an extensive history. I did it with Seven Dust, did it with Megadeth. You know, bands that typically have more than 10 or 11 albums, I do this with. Didn't really do it with Slayer. I might go back and do that again. But yeah, for In Flames, right now I'm finishing up Come Clarity again, but that's the album I kind of already knew the best. So that one was pretty easy to determine what my favorite tracks were. But so the way it works for me with In Flames, and probably with a lot of other fans of that band, is I think it comes down to taste and vocal style. Now, obviously, musically, there was a shift around the turn of the century. They became more metalcore and alternative rather than like classic death metal or melodic death metal, whatever you want to call it. Back in the 90s, you know, they sounded like more traditional death metal. Whereas these days, they sound more metalcore, not maybe so much with like breakdowns, but just like the style of riffing, a little heavier on the rhythm section. You know, they're still like good leads and melodies and everything, but they're not like as shred happy on the solos or anything like that. So, taking away a little bit of the speed in essence of, again, alternative metal sounds. But what, I think what really separates the 90s, which is mostly like three odd albums, depending on if you count Lunar Eclipse and Subterranean, or Lunar Strain, sorry. Again, I'm not really counting Subterranean or Lunar Strain because those albums don't have Anders on it. Those are kind of just like the old albums. I kind of consider Jester Race their first real album. But, you know, I'll go back and listen to those albums at some point, but I'm not really talking about them right now. So, what really changed, though, around the year 2000 with Clayman, and subsequently with Reroute to Remain, was the vocal style. It was less death metal growls and more of a different kind of scream. So Anders' voice changed. I'm not sure why, if it was just for stylistic reasons or maybe for preservation of voice. But I think that's probably the biggest thing that separates the school of thought or school of preference for In Flames fans is, do you like more of the death metal style growling that you hear in Jester Race or Horacle or even Colony? Or do you like more variety like you hear in pretty much every album since Clayman? And definitely a lot more so in the 2010s albums. Or even go back as far as Sense of Purpose in 2008. So for me, I like it all. And I'm sure there's a lot of In Flames fans that like it all too. But I did go back and re-listen to the Jester Race, which I knew a lot of classic or traditional metalheads. I won't call them elitist because I don't think they have that air about them, but you can kind of tell what kind of metalhead you're talking to when you figure out what their favorite albums are from certain bands that have certain varieties. And if you're talking to an In Flames fan and they love Horacle or Jester Race, like that's their top album, they're probably more of a classic like metal fan. But like me, I think their best album is probably Come Clarity, which that album has a little bit more variety, but that album is still fucking heavy. It's fast, it's aggressive. I think it's the best, it probably has the best mix, it's got the best variety of tracks on there, and the songs that are heavy are fucking heavy. And the guitar work on that album is sick. And Anders' voice, vocal performance on that album, to me, is top tier. So, to me, that's their best album. But I think Horacle is a brilliant album, and upon re-listening to Jester Race again, that album is definitely awesome. I was able to pick a couple tracks off that album to put on my playlist. I need to re-listen to Horacle, do the same thing, but like Colony from 1999, that's an excellent album. And then the same thing with Clayman. So still need to go through the newer In Flames albums and do that. And then the album that I've really been neglecting for pretty much my entire time of knowing about the band is probably A Sense of Purpose, because they did something weird with the guitar tones on that one. But it's not a bad album. There's some good songs on there. And then same thing with Sounds of a Playground Fading. So that's that, at least for now, with In Flames. That'll probably be the band I'm talking about for the next couple months. We'll see. But also, Eminem dropped a surprise album, Music to be Murdered By. It's got a handful of great tracks on there. Of course, in Eminem fashion, there's a couple of weird-ass tracks on there that just don't make any sense. But I'm not sure where I think the new album stands. you can pretty much expect at least a handful of any tracks on almost any Eminem album to be solid. And of course, he keeps going with like the machine gun style speed of which he's rapping. He's keeping that going, and I like it. But sometimes I yearn for the old school days of like the Eminem show, where speed wasn't the forefront of his skill. It was more storytelling and everything like that. But you can't deny that the speed and the punchlines that he delivers aren't top tier. The guy's the rap. He's the rap god. He is rap god. He's the goat of rap. You can't fuck with him. I need to re-listen to the album a couple more times, but it gave me a pretty strong first impression. Maybe almost as strong as a first impression as Kamikaze. There's a song in there called Stepdad, which is funny as hell. And I'm like, shit, I thought the song I wrote about my stepdad was brutal. That song's not released, by the way, so keep an eye out for that this decade. That's right. I give myself a decade to actually release Raptor Riot music. Thanks to the 12-week year, and one of my goals being to spend a consistent amount of time, 75 minutes a week on Guitar Pro, I've actually spent a couple hours on it the past month. And because of that, I almost have a new song complete. Maybe not almost complete, but it's pretty far along. It's an old track. I'm excited about it, and I'll talk more about it on the next podcast. Yo, what's up? It's January 16th, 2020. It's a Thursday evening. Thursday night. It's 8:30. I just got out of the gym. I'm a little winded. Hitting the bench a little harder. The 5x5 is going well in the sense that, you know, I'm going the 3 days a week, but I kind of bitch out and don't do all three movements. I mostly focus on the bench. I know that's incorrect, but when I do have the extra energy, of course, I do some leg movements. I either do squats or deadlifts, and there's other ones you can throw in there, like overhead press or bent rows or barbell curls. But with the bench, I always superset it with pull-ups and a little hand grip thingies, so as to encourage more forearm growth and stronger hands and vascularity. So I'm working on that. Let's see, on this particular clip, I want to talk about in Flames. Let's see, how long ago did they start there? What the hell is this EP? Oh, it's a Hot Topic exclusive EP. I guess these are bonus tracks or B-sides. Anyway, I've listened to most of their discography. I think they have 13 albums. Let me see, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14. They usually say 14. I guess they combine the Lunar Strain EP or just the Subterranean album, the first two albums. In Flames, I think they're Swedish. They've been around since 1994. I think the band formed in 90. So it's just one of those bands that like I listened to in high school, I guess kind of during their peak years. Much like Killswitch Engage or Trivium or Shadows Fall. A lot of metalcore bands, Chimera, that I was really into during those years. And that I've revisited quite a bit and I look back on pretty fondly. Metalcore, melodic death, metalcore. In Flames is one of those bands that I just decided to kind of come back and give another shot. It might have been because they put out an album last year and I was like, oh, I should listen to that. But then I was like, holy crap. They have all these other albums from last decade that I didn't really get into. Should probably go back and re-listen to some of that. So, overall, I know there's kind of two different types of In Flames fans. There's the old school fans that are, you know, kind of like metal purists. They're just like, no, we're only going to like the stuff. Either Clayman, which came out in 2000, I think it was like their fifth album. Clayman was the last good album, or that was when the band became too mainstream. It started becoming like less melodic death metal and more like alternative metalcore with some melodic death elements in there. oh my God, he's actually singing now. I'm on the side of the fence. And then the other fans are the ones that like their more alternative metalcore sounding stuff with catchier hooks and like more metalcore sounding stuff with like breakdowns or, yeah, pretty much, that's pretty much it. Basically, after the year 2000 and before the year 2000, and, you know, obviously on the other side of 2000, In Flames have put out more albums on that side. So, ultimately, when I was getting started back then, I was listening to the albums that were out at the time. Back in high school, I was listening to the Come Clarity album and the soundtrack to Your Escape. And then, you know, later on in the decade, I was living with a friend of mine, well, former friend, but at the time, friend, In Flames was his favorite band. And Sounds of a Playground Fading was an album that was relatively new, and we listened to a little bit of that together. In his car, he would play Reroute to Remain a lot. And all these albums I just mentioned are post-2000. So, again, I kind of fall on the other side. A lot of my friends and former friends that were, like, purist metalheads, they all say that, like, The Jester Raced is the best album. You know, it's the first album with Anders. I'm not even going to count the first two albums, Lunar Strain and Subterranean. I'm not going to count those albums because they don't have... They have the old singer, and pretty much Anders has been the guy for pretty much all of In Flames. So I would really say The Jester Raced is, like, their first album, and that's as far back as I'll go. I went back and listened to the first two albums, technical first albums, but I'll have to give them another listen, but I'm just not really feeling them. So I'm pretty much starting a Jester Raced. You know, again, kind of a traditional death metal album. Need to listen to it again. Wasn't too huge on it, but a lot of the stuff was pretty groundbreaking and pretty damn good for the time. And then Horacle, the following album, 97. Jester Raced came out in 96. Horacle is 97. Cover Killer Nation is another guy that I watched to kind of get some insight on metal music and everything like that. And, you know, I like his open-mindedness and kind of his direct and insightful input into the metal community and bands at large. Horacle's his favorite album, and he said that it's kind of like that perfect blend between their old school stuff and kind of bringing in a little bit of the melodic catchiness and everything. I think I like Horacle better than Jester Race, but I had to listen to it again. Colony, 1999. That's an album that I dig very much. I think, as far as I can tell right now, up until a certain point, In Flames kind of gets better with every release. And don't piss your pants just yet, okay? That's just kind of what I'm hearing so far, but Colony, there's a song on there called Embody the Invisible. It's the first track. That's on Tony Hawk Underground, an old PS2 game, one of the best Tony Hawk games out there. So I've always known that song, and I finally went back and listened to that whole album. It's pretty damn good. Same thing for Clayman, which I believe, for the most part, is probably In Flames' most popular album. It came out in 2000. It's got their biggest track on there, Only for the Weak. I love the track Bullet Ride. I think I was listening to, like, metalcore radio or something, or I was listening to an album on Spotify, and then for some odd reason, In Flames' Bullet Ride came on, and I was like, holy crap, this song's amazing. It's a great opening track, and I love it. I was listening to it, like, obsessively during the New Year's 2020 break. So Clayman's kind of a Las Vegas album for me right now, and I was just listening to it at the gym. It's a great album to lift to. I love the track Clayman, Satellites and Astronauts, of course the first couple tracks, so I'm still listening. Then we have Reroute to Remain, which is where most people say the actual change between the genres took place. I listened to that full album a couple days ago. It was a pretty good impression. Some of the tracks I remembered from back in the day. I also listened to it again, but it might not be one of my favorite albums. Soundtrack to Your Escape. That's the first In Flames album I ever listened to. Back in my sophomore year of high school, my friend had it. And I never fully listened to it or fully got into it, but like the intro to Touch of Red and a couple of other tracks really got me like loving their guitar tone and like Anders' unique voice. And I just love the drop A sharp tuning because up until that point, they were predominantly playing in drop C standard. Or C standard, rather. So a lot of metal bands do that. They don't play in drop tunings. They like that, you know, standard playing. But Soundtrack to Your Escape is probably one of my favorite albums, even though it's got some filler tracks in it. And then following that is the most important album for me, is Come Clarity. This has, like, pretty much all my favorite In Flames tracks. Not all of them, but a lot of them. Like, to me, this is probably their best album. It was the album that was the biggest while I was listening to them, and pretty much while they were at their peak, I think. You know, like, Crawl Through Knives, fucking the song Scream. It just occurred to me that the fucking chorus to Scream is very reminiscent of my song from Raptor Riot, Sabotaged. It's got it has the first two notes in the chorus. The dun dun dun. They're different, but they're reminiscent. So when I hear Scream, I feel like I'm listening to Raptor Riot. That makes me horny. And then Reflect the Storm is one of my favorite In Flames songs ever. And then Take This Life is, of course, a classic. See how far into this podcast. Holy shit, I'm already 9 minutes into this. This wasn't meant to be fully an In Flames podcast clip, but basically, yeah, I'm getting up to the point where I don't really know too much about the rest of the albums. Sense of Purpose has a couple good tracks on there. Pretty much every In Flames album up to this point, Sense of Purpose, Sounds of a Playground Fading, Siren Charms, Battles, and I the Mask, those last tracks from the past decade, all have at least a couple of good tracks on there. So all in all, In Flames is a solid band. Every album has tracks on there worth listening to, but much like Megadeth or Slayer or other bands that I got into, like, or Seven Dust, I'm still getting acquainted to the discography right now. But right now I'm really happy that this is kind of my new band right now. But it's like a new band revisited, because I definitely wasn't an In Flames fan there back then. I just haven't listened to them in a while. But I've listened to pretty much every album all the way through at least once, except for, again, the albums that don't have Anders in them from the mid-90s. But as for the other 12-ish albums, yeah, I've listened to pretty much all of them at least once, but not with full intention and not with full... I basically need to make an In Flames playlist and take the best tracks off of every album and basically have a nice little 35 to 45 track playlist of, like, the best of In Flames. So that's that. I'm surprised they haven't done, like, a greatest hits yet. I don't think a lot of metal bands do that. But yeah, so that's that. My bench is going up. Today I benched 165 five times. So, you know, my goal was to get to my body weight 185 again by the end of this month. I think I can do it. And again, by the end of this, you know, first round of 12-week year, my goal, which will be the end of February, or end of March, my goal is to have it up to 225, you know, daddy weight, 245s on each side. But yeah, right now, this is where the most growth is happening, because I always warm up with 135, and, you know, adding in those 5s and 10s on each side, you know, sprinkle those in throughout the week, and you can kind of do that a little easier. But as soon as you kind of hit, like, that ceiling of 185... every 5 to 10 pounds you add between that, it gets harder and harder. But, you know, I was able to do it at one point. I think the most I've ever been able to do, I think I did 225 at least once or twice in my life. I knew that back then my max was like 210 or 205, so a 45 and a 35 on each side. But, like, during my better days, I could rep 185 pretty comfortably. So I'm getting back to that right now. And I will talk with y'all soon.